So, we've got 5 markers and 3 codes. How many execute markers are produced at the ADA using the utilization of a target tag? So, if any of these questions, the state of the module will be applied to those modules. It's probably at 1.25. Okay, so take 4 units of module. How many ATP produced by FPGAs in the transport chain? And here I've got one thing to review. Okay, so the process produces 2 modules of NADH, which get converted to FPGAs when they get translocated into some mitochondria. And each of those FPGAs produces 2 ATP. So you get 4 ATP from FPGAs derived from the glycolysis. And then, of course, if you've got a glucose, it's 2 3 carbon units. You get 2 turns of the TCA cycle. Each turn of the TCA cycle gives you 2 FAD molecules. Each of those FAD gives you 2 ATP, so you get 4 ATP generated from FAD derived from the TCA cycle. So in total, you get 8 ATP molecules solely from the use of FADH. If you have 8 ATP molecules from 1 more glucose, then the 5 molecules of glucose are going to be 4. Okay. Everyone happy? I should let you know now that a sea of blank cosmetic faces is yes, but very, very happy. Okay. Probably the last number for those TCA cycles inhibited in some way. So how many ATP molecules are produced for 17 glucose molecules being metabolized? And we're going to be substituting in weird feedback inhibition processes going on, which you will happen. So effectively, how much happens if you don't have TCA cycle function? Well, if you have TCA cycle function, ATP is still produced here. So you get 2 ATP from the glycolysis, still FADH produced, and that FADH is still beating to the transport chain. So the glycolysis still gives you 2 ATP. It also gives you 2 FADH, which therefore gives you 4 ATP. You also get the lytic reactions still occurring. So the lytic reactions still occur. And that gives you 2 NADH for every bottle of glucose. There's 2 NADH that will give you 3 ATP each, so give you 6 ATP in total. But the TCA cycle doesn't function because they're still quite completely contributing to the TCA cycle, so there's nothing else to do with that. So effectively, you get 6 plus 4 plus 2, 12 ATP for every single glucose. And then 17 times 12, therefore, gives you your answer. So it's 4. Yeah, so it's a fair amount of TCA cycle will pop. All the other things, NADH and FADH, still feed into the different transport chain, because you don't get any of this stuff produced from the TCA cycle. Okay, so let's start with one of the different models again. So, what we do is we have 2 ATP produced from the process, but that doesn't count because that's already in the cytosol, and we have 2 ATP molecules that need to be transported from the cytosol from the mitochondria into the cytosol for use. You get the 2 FADH from the process, so you get 4 ATP here still. You get the lytic chain reaction. So the lytic chain reaction doesn't produce or produces an NADH, but the NADH can't bind to complex 1, so that doesn't happen. So we ignore that. So far we've got 4 ATP from FADH. TCA cycle, here, the one molecule of glucose gives you 2 ATP directly. Yeah, we've got 2 runs of TCA cycle, you get two ATPs directly from the TCA cycle, you get one from the DX molecule, and that behaves normally, one FDA gives you, one FDA gives you two ATP. You've got two FDAs, one of those, you've got one glucose, so you get four ATP. And you have any ATPs, still, but that's an interesting thing. So, in fact, you've got four ATP molecules. None of the NADH gives you any ATP. So you get 10 molecules for every one of the glucose. You've got 42. Yeah, glucose molecules. They will make 420 ATP. And you have five possible answers. Your job is to eliminate as many of the wrong answers as possible. The definition is one way to eliminate all answers. You get one mark for every wrong answer that you identify. And as you get to the four marks, you get more than identified. If you identify the correct answer as being correct, you get minus 4 marks. So, in this question, you've got 10 markers of glucose, you've got a time of molecules of juice did not require to be transferred to the site soil from the mitochondria. Basically, how many ATP are produced in the site soil by any of this process? And that only applies to these two here. So the answer is 20. The key to these questions is to look for the wrong answers. Okay? If you have 10 molecules of glucose, all the number of ATP molecules you can produce are all numbers. And if the answers are not divisible to give you a whole number as a result by 10, they're not the right answer. So you can exclude A and B just because they don't divide by 10 to give you a whole number. You don't produce half an ATP molecule. You don't produce 2.4 ATP molecules. So if you look at the answers, you can exclude that correct answers or identify answers as being incorrect without actually knowing anything about glycolysis and TCA cycle. What you get is basically you've got 10 molecules of glucose, so you either produce 1, 2, or 3 ATP molecules. Which is what? Many of you can get it from that. Metabolize how many ATP molecules are produced to require the transfer level. The relation of the between complex 1 and complex 2 is what it is. Okay? So, we move these two ATP here. So glucolysis gives us 4 MFADH. If electrical flow between complex 1 and complex 2 is inhibited, basically that means MFADH, which binds complex 2, doesn't do anything between complex 1 and 2, behaves normally. Yeah? If we did it by complex 2, pass its electrons to complex 3 and complex 4, you get proton pumping at complex 3 and 4, and you get 2 molecules of ATP produced. MFADH will still bind in complex 1. When it binds complex 1, it will cause proton pumping, and that proton pumping will produce ATP. But you won't get any further ATP production from NADH. So all you've done is every time you've got an NADH molecule, that will produce 2 ATP, it will produce 1 ATP. So, and the ATP never needs to be transferred from the mitochondria to the cytosol. So, if you get into the force cell, the NADH here, because you've got 2 NADH molecules, we're going to give you 2. We'll still get 2 from ATP, we'll still get 4 from FADH. That'll give you 4, as I said, you can. And then the 6 molecules here give you 1 ATP. What I should give you is a set of 18 ATP molecules for glucose. And then make 10 of those, or I give you 180. And so, basically, the number of ATP you get from NADH is 24 originally, but that goes down from 24 to 8, because you're only getting 1 ATP rather than 3 ATP for any NADH. And yes, you can ignore anything that's not divisible by 10.
initiative, that's the district getting 4680 produced. And by definition, if something is inhibiting something, you're going to get less than 80p than normal. If you get 4680p normally, you're going to get less than 4680p for glucose when something's inhibited. So it can't be those two because they're divided by 10. It can't be as long as this would assume it affects behavior normally. So in principle, we just identify 1, 2, 5 as being threat in 75% of the marks. Need more work in the question there and not do anything more and still get to 75%. Okay. Any questions? No. That's a question. Okay, hold on. Two products. You take fatty acid and you break it down three units and five testers, which are attached to our pistol. We'll come back to where we get into in a second. So structurally, plenty of acids have a blissful backbone, so three carbon backbones, three carbon put together. Each of those carbons is a stereophile to the fatty acid chain. And the fatty acid chains tend to be saturated carbon chains, so each of these things is a carbon. And you can have C16, C18, let's look at resistors in here. Carbogenic chains, and you've got saturated carbons usually. Unsaturated in some cases, the most saturated carbon oxide. And you have this little carbon with three fatty acids stuck to each of the carbons. They tend to be more energetic because it takes less water to hydrolyze them. You get more carbon material for the same amount of water, so you get almost twice as much energy from the fatty acid as you do sugar. So to use fatty acid for energy, first we're going to break it away, use a lipase enzyme, and hydrolyze up the fatty acids from the glycerol. And you end up with glycerol, C3 units, and three fatty acids, like a chain. And each of those, so the glycerol is used in a different way from the fatty acids. So if we deal with glycerol first, glycerol effectively feeds into the blood surface, and it feeds in the glycerol glycerin phosphate. Okay? So you take glycerol, which is a free carbon unit, and get phosphorylated. And again, you use an ATP to do so. And it then gets oxidized, producing NADH as a result, and that gives you diarsine phosphate, which basically are summarizes to glycerol-3 phosphates. Okay, so you take that 3 carbon, you phosphorylate it, and you oxidize this to effectively produce glycerol-3 phosphates. Because you've only got one C3 unit, acids are easy. Okay? Fatty acids are basically degraded as two carbons at a time. You take a C16 carbon, so a fatty acid is 16 carbons in a row, and you break it down two carbon chunks. Each of those two carbon chunks becomes a dissolved away. And therefore, every two carbon chunks, you get one chunk of the TCA cell. So you have a C16 chain. The C16 chain breaks down into eight two carbon units. Yeah, you've got 16 carbons, you have eight sets of two carbons. And therefore, you get eight turns of the TCA cycle. Each turn of the TCA cycle gives you 12 ATP. And therefore, you can work out how many ATP you get. Simple as that. Okay, so I've set a series of questions online for next time, which cover this as well as glucose. And we'll get to those in the next lecture. Slightly out of order, but we probably do need to start with where we started, which is how you get glucose in the first place. Of course, you get glucose in photosynthesis. All we need to know is that photosynthesis has light reactions and dark reactions. The light reactions produce ATP and ATPH, and that can then be used to fix CO2 into glucose. So the light reactions produce ATP and reduce carbon and ATPH. For the dark reactions, or the carbon cycle, then they use that to fix carbon and dioxide in the form of glucose. They do this because they have the ability to capture light energy, and that ability is caused by deuterium chlorophyll. So chlorophyll is an example of porphyrin. Porphyrins have this conjugated ring structure, where you have a double bond, single bond, or single bond throughout the entire structure. So you have a huge delocalized electron system, and in the case of porphyrin, they collect magnesium. The other structural thing about chlorophyll is it has something called a phytol tail, so a non-fatty acid tail stuck to the end of it. And that allows the chlorophyll to embed in membranes. This fatty acid tail makes it hydrophobic, or this part hydrophobic, and that allows the chlorophyll to anchor the membranes to the thyroid membrane, and that's where it accumulates in there to make a very dense collation of chlorophyll, where it accepts light energy. So, it absorbs energy where it is in the light spectrum, so 380 to 750. And if you put chlorophyll as a cryptometer, you get absorbed spectra. And supposedly, it doesn't absorb around this region because it's green, it's chlorophyll, it's past green. And the light you see, or the color of something, the light is not absorbed. All the other wavelengths of light are heavily absorbed, and it's the first piece of absorption. So chlorophyll allows absorption here and here, but not in this region. Whilst chlorophyll is very abundant, there are other pigments within plants which allow for absorption in the rest of the light range. So there's a combination of different pigments which allow for absorption across the whole spectrum. You don't know these members don't absorb where they are. So briefly, what happens in photosynthesis is light causes electron excitation, so it gives some energy, and that allows electrons to pass down an electron transport chain, similar to that found in metabolism and energy production. And it interacts with two photosystems. Each of those photosystems recognizes a different wavelength of the light, so it maximizes the number of different wavelengths of light which can be taken up by the plant and used to produce energy. So, photosystem 2 recognizes light below 680. Photosystem 1 recognizes light below 700. So, they're relatively close in absorbance. But collectively, between the two of them, they have a wider absorbance range alone. And fundamental problems is you have a light absorbance, which excites electron, you know, circuit P450, or P680 in this case. That electron is then passed down the transport chain,
As the past has done, the transport chain causes proton pumping again. Is that what we saw in the transport chain for metabolism? And then the second, so that finally reduces ADP and ADH. So there are two transport chains, each allowed for proton pumping. And again, that proton pumping moves proteins into the final part of space and then allows them to pump through ATP synthase, which allows for the synthesis of ATP. You also get ADPH, which produces a byproduct of that electron transport as well. So there are two molecules of ATP and one molecule of ADPH through electron flow in the gas system. There's lone actions that produce oxygen, because they're splitting water here to get the electrons in the first place. It's oxygen, ATP, and ADPH. The dark reactions, the other set of reactions in photosynthesis, then use that ATP and ADPH to reduce CO2, and this is the process of the carbon cycle. Starch and complex sugars.
on how photosynthesis has light reactions, dark reactions, and what each one makes for us, and how it produces a carbon. Okay. Good news. Basically, for this episode, that's all you need to remember. The rest of the plans tell you won't be in the exam. But we do need to cover vampires and human warriors. This leads back to chlorophyll. So chlorophyll is an example of a form structure. Yeah, you've got this conjugated bond system, and effectively got four repeating units. So these structures are a little complicated. They're actually very, very simple. You've basically got four carbons, 1, 2, 3, 4, stuck to a nitrogen, another carbon linking it to the same thing again. A handful of some properties on the outside, but fundamentally they're very simple structures. We've come across porphyrin, although we've come across porphyrins before. Porphyrins also make heme groups for hemoglobin. So a heme group within hemoglobin is also a porphyrin structure. You've got this four carbon, one nitrogen unit repeating this structure. And this time, rather than complexing magnesium, it's complexing iron. And so hemoglobin has extremely important components. It's got a heme group, which is a porphyrin, and the globin, which is the protein structure. The globin is the protein which binds to the heme group, and that's the chirioxygen. So, we use hemoglobin to carry oxygen around the body, transport to the tissues and the lungs. Other species use different things. So, horseshoe crabs and some other species use hemocyanin instead, where you have a copper complexing into the heme, so the protein. And therefore, we get blue blood because the absorbance spectrum is affected by the copper rather than the iron being complex. But you should be aware that not all hemocyanins are the same. So, hemocyanin is the horseshoe crab replacement for hemoglobin. Octopuses also have hemocyanin as well. I usually get on with most of my colleagues, but the most heated debate we've had recently is what is the plural for an octopus? Everyone's happy with it, but we have octopuses and octopuses for about 2 days. But interestingly, there are different hemocyanin products that you can use. So if you take octopuses from different places, the Antarctic, temperate waters, subtropical waters, so these three here, and you look at the hemocyanins, they have different properties. For our Antarctic species, they have increased affinity, but lower saturations. They take less oxygen on, but they do it more rapidly. There's a lot more oxygen in cold water, so the equilibrium constant is more. So there's a less, they don't need to take as much on in one go, but they do it very easily and rapidly when they want to. And so they have different protein structures, they produce different hemocyanin products to behave or respond to their different environments. And you can see that if you look at how much, if you vary the pH and look at the curves of oxygen saturation in these things, you get the same curve at different temperatures. So this one from the Antarctic behaves well at 0 degrees, where it needs 10 degrees or 20 degrees to do the same if the octopus comes from temperate or tropical region. So it all develops subtly different hemocyanin forms to account for the oxygen and how easily it transports around. Similarly, Trantum is also containing hemocyanin. And if you take that hemocyanin from a Trantum and you expose it to 80 degrees for 30 minutes or longer, it alters how that hemocyanin produced carries oxygen. Because if the Trantum is in the desert, it needs to have hemocyanin that will adapt to changes in temperature over time and alter the oxygen consumption or the potential oxygen based on the surrounding temperature. Skinks are different again. Okay, so skinks are these fundamental lizards that live in Madagascar. They've all evolved and separated away from everything else and they're weird things. Skinks, rather than hemoglobin, a large proportion of their blood is a degradation product of hemoglobin called bilirubin. Okay, so their green blood
as well, which is the production of the first sales and things like that. And the key agreement, at least we can agree with, and the first we do is we really implement the site structure. Yeah, this should be round, it should be cyclical, you should have a bond here, all together. You have a rear thing, you have a non-cyclical structure, which is that. The highest level recorded in humans is 50 micromolar, and that just before a person died, with a toxic accumulation of the vivarium. Skinks have values of up to 100 micromolar in the bloodstream. So they have evolved a protective mechanism to allow them to live with increased levels of vivarium. So, if you get a rupture of red blood cells and you see hemoglobin is dealt with in a number of ways by blood. Basically, the first thing you do is you take the blood with it, the protein, and you break it down to amino acids, which can be very useful. You then put the hemoglobin. The hemoglobin tends to be toxic, so it breaks into the vivarium. So what you're going to check is in the bloodstream, and then part with it, the main blood protein, you fix it up, you take the parasite around the bloodstream safely, and draw it to the liver. The liver, you get a sugar stuck to it. So you get a conjugation of the bivarium, of bilirubin, sorry, with the sugar, with the light, and that makes it more soluble and less toxic. Once it's less toxic, that sugar conjugate gets chucked into the spinal system, the bacteria on it, and it gets converted to either your urobilinogen, released in the urine, or steroglobulin, released in feces. And that's what gives your yellow color, feces brown color. The most interesting experiment I've accidentally carried out myself, well, I said I didn't carry it myself, someone else did it for me, was I was giving blood for some research in RS1, and I made a mistake of letting the doctor take the blood rather than the nurse do it, because the nurse was on the radio. They struck the heart around with a piece of blood pressure in your arm, stick the needle in, and they get all your blood, and it's all very well. You're supposed to manage to catch a piece of blood pressure for all the new drugs. How is this doctor? So he pulls the needle out of his desk, pulls the clamp still on, and this pool of blood encompasses just below your skin. And my whole underside of my arm turned green, and then yellow in the next couple of days. Just makes it wash. So this degradation between these green and yellow colours as the hemoglobin degrades. So skinks, they've got this high level of bilirubin in the bloodstream. A, because it makes them a lot less tasty. So birds come along, eat one of the lizards, die very rapidly. All the other birds soon learn less and don't eat any more lizards. It can act as an antioxidant, so it protects the lizard against UV rays and damage from UV rays from the sun. But more importantly, it prevents against infection of the plasmodium that causes malaria. What's
course, it can do that with human groups, it can't do it with a living human. So they can't infect an individual because it can't deal with programs with living human, but it can't form a polar species from the disrupted human morphine structure. So having blood out for the immune in the blood, and this stops it being infected by that parasite. This is also the mechanism by which many antiparasitic or anti-malaria drugs work. Many anti-malaria drugs recently was chloroquine. So you go to a place where there's a high incidence of malaria, you generally take chloroquine before you go. Chloroquine basically prevents heme polymerization. So stops the parasite from the heme toxicity in the blood. And therefore, you don't get parasites and you don't get malaria. If you have hyperbilirubin in the blood, this is a tune of condition, we'll try to be hyperbilirubinemic. Okay? Hyperbilirubinemic. Yes, of course. This is just high levels of anemic levels of bilirubin in the blood. It exhibits this yellow skin, so sort of jaundice, because you're getting the degradation of heme into the green, bilirubin and bilirubin in the yellow color. So you get elevated levels of bilirubin in the bloodstream. The two main causes of hyperbilirubinemia is either some form of disruption to the red blood cells, so that liver disease causes this, sickle cell anemia, any blood disorder where you get disruption to red blood cells causes massive release of hemoglobin into the blood, and then we get massive release of bilirubin. Or disconjugated intracellular disrupted intracellular conjugation. So remember the liver has to conjugate bilirubin to sugar to be able to make it easier to get rid of. If the liver isn't working well, then you don't know that doesn't happen. And this occurs mostly in newborn babies. Newborn babies, when a baby's in the womb, all its blood is being sorted out by the mother. Doesn't have to worry about byproducts or anything, but it's liver can sit there doing nothing. As soon as the baby is born, it has to start coping with life. And it takes a while for the liver to start expressing the protein at higher concentration to be able to cope with the bilirubin. So initially, you get increased bilirubin in newborn children because the liver isn't ready to start metabolizing that bilirubin yet. And therefore, there is jaundice, it suffers from bilirubinemia in about a set of cases. The easiest way to solve this, or main reason mechanism of treating it, to stick the baby in an incubator. So you obviously use the incubators because the bilirubin is not UV sensitive. Okay? It's not. It can be photocatalyzed or photocatalytically degraded by the UV. They used to use fluorescent lights in baby incubators, but LED is just as well, and they're cheaper to use in places like India. So you can use mice in the incubators to deal with the fact that newborn babies can't metabolize porphyrins in the same way that they should be able to. So some problems come from that, metabolize them. Other disorders come back from the fact that you can't biosynthesize porphyrins. So to make heme, you have to make it from scratch. You make it from glycine and something like RNA. There's a long pathway of biosynthesis, each group of enzymes, whether you step, etc. And there are two main enzyme defects that occur in that pathway, and they give you a range of diseases called porphyrias. So porphyrias are diseases of heme biosynthesis, to disrupt the ability to synthesize hemoglobin, or heme hemoglobin at least. This gives rise to symptoms of vampire disease. So the porphyrias, often known as the vampire disease, due to symptoms, people become sensitive to light, they start to have red eyes, red teeth, because of the accumulation of the byproducts of the porphyrin biosynthesis pathway, and they start developing excessive body hair, and gives them characteristics not like that of vampire. Also, this accumulation of byproducts also causes seizures and mental health issues, insanity. And this is the association with King George III. The main product
So, can you refer to this by Marcus?
The main reason that falls happened is because there's an arsenic, there's been prescribed arsenic as a medicine, and the arsenic is interfering with the proper biosynthesis pathway. And therefore, it's causing the failure, and that gave rise to clinical symptoms. So, that's why you all very much like a more vampire. Okay, so far, just to recap, we covered we've done the same fatty acids. Any questions online?